Will you pray with me? Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations on all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. For you are our rock and our redeemer, now and forever. Amen. I'm really nervous. You guys tell me not to be nervous. Okay, thank you. Yeah. People I know that have endured great pain often have greatest faith and peace. I had a friend. Her name was Laura Markham. I met Laura when we were both 8 years old. I remember her wide smile, her wispy blonde hair, her long fingers. I remember how she taught me that Kraft mac and cheese tasted good with just a little bit of salt and pepper on it. I remember how we dressed up in her basement and danced around to Madonna and Cyndi Lauper songs. And I remember that the first time I met her, our mutual friend Kristen took me aside to explain Laura's illness. Laura had cystic fibrosis and was not expected to make it to adulthood. She got a lung transplant in high school, and she lived for a while with her new lungs, but in the end, her body rejected them. But Laura was ready. She lived her whole life knowing she might never make it to 18 and praying for a miracle. And I never knew what that was like for her, really. I only know what I witnessed in her, that in the end, she knew that God had taken her body's weakness and filled her with the strength she was supposed to have. Laura was a vessel of Christ's light to everyone that knew her, and she trusted that. People I know that have endured great pain often have greatest faith and peace. I used to think that kind of great faith was born out of a fear of dying, or a fear of being alone, or a fear of the pain itself. But pain brings us closer to truth and light. Pain with a purpose, emotional pain, physical pain, creates a stronger self. It's in our weaknesses that we are able to see the hand of God reaching to lift us from despair. When life is good and normal and even, I don't reach for my brushes or my pens or even the friend of a hand to hold. Pain creates a need within me to look outside of myself for help and healing. When life is rocky, I put aside my pride and ask for help from God and from my family. When life is rocky and pain is present, I can tell myself that there's a reason. But when I'm looking at someone else's situation, I can't in good conscience tell them to trust that their pain is for a purpose. Only the student in the school of suffering can learn that hard life lesson, and only if they're willing to let go of boastfulness and proclaim their weaknesses. Telling someone like Laura, who is experiencing each breath as a drowning plea, that her agony is going to save her is likely to earn me a slap in the face and her more pain. Few want to hear as they gasp for breath that they can be consolers or teachers to the ones who follow them. No one wants to celebrate their pain. How many of us can find the purpose in our pain when we're experiencing it? I keep thinking about pain with a purpose, about how pain and weakness allow us to find God wherever that is for us, in a friend, in art, in nature, in music. And about how pain teaches us things that nothing else can, how it prepares us for things nothing else can, and how it allows us to care for others in a way nothing else can. I don't believe God gives us pain to teach us. But I think the beauty that God creates from dust is what redeems us when we can either choose to be swallowed by the pain and weakness or to rise up and find the hidden blessing in the rubble. Paul was accused of being less than perfect and of being weak, of leading a church and then leaving them spiritually adrift. And he responded with, "Right, guys, I'm totally not perfect. And I'm going to own that. It's actually not a bad thing." Paul's approach is one of humility. I've ever told you how little I actually know about the Bible. What irony. I'm here preaching a sermon about weakness, and this preaching feels like a weakness. By some standards, I'm not equipped with the right language and knowledge to be preaching. I didn't go to seminary. I don't even hold any college degree. But through my weakness, my Bible trivia ignorance, I can glorify God. Because if I can get this, if I can do this, if I can stand up here in front of you and be a vessel for God's message, it isn't by any skill or will of my own, but by God's voice, God's word, God's will. God doesn't give help to us when we don't ask for it. Last week, my 3.5-year-old niece, Vanessa, was riding Grayson's bike. And even though she's just a year younger than my son, her little 3-year-old legs could barely reach the pedals. She's just a tiny little thing. Maybe you saw her. She's visiting. But like every preschool I've ever met, she has this streak of independence that's infinitely larger than her pint-sized self. And in that moment, I saw her start to get frustrated with getting the bicycle going. She blurted out that she needed help and that she could do it at the same exact time. Oh, child, that's it. Right there. We need help. All the time, and it's okay. It's okay to ask for help. It's okay to admit that we're weak, and we don't understand, and we need a hug, and that we can't reach the pedals. That's how we get help. We reach out and own our shortcomings, and then we trust. Admitting weakness takes a lot of trust. You have to believe that if you put in the brave efforts of burying your belly, you won't find claws sinking in. That's a cat reference. I had an awful day last Wednesday. Yeah, I witnessed and received hurtful sexist and homophobic behavior by 3 different people who I care about. I received a less than desirable email from my child's teacher, and I was denied a grant request for Creative Encountering program funding. It was a huge grant. It was one that would have allowed me to move Creative Encountering further into the community and to do bigger things, and the answer felt spirit-crushing to me. And then to top the day off, I broke one of Hamilton's beautiful paintings. I wanted to go home. I wanted to quit life for the day. I wanted to move my belongings to a dark cave and not come out for a while. But instead, I cried in the chapel by myself. And then I reached out. I talked to people who love me. And I sat in a circle with 11 other people to sing and pray and light candles and experience the joy of trusting God's grace to get me through. Grace did more than get me through. As soon as I broke open and conceded my weakness, light began to fill me. That Wednesday evening spiritual gathering, we lit candles first for people that we see the light of God in. Then we lit candles for those whom we hope to shine God's light. I lit 2 candles for those I hope to always shine for. The first was for Grayson, of course. Then I lit the second one for Christ. I could have lit a candle for each of you, for all the people I know, for everyone I will someday meet. But really what I mean is that I want to shine for Christ. I want to shine so the Spirit can do work through me. I want to submit myself and admit my cracks and make room for authenticity of spirit. I can either hide in a dark cave or trust grace to get me through. The part of me that was crushed by not getting that grant money was the doubt that creeps in when I'm not trusting in God's grace. It's the thorn in my flesh. It's the messenger of Satan that torments me. I have an embarrassing confession to make. Doubt runs in me deeply at times, and I ask God to send me signs that I'm on the right track, that I'm doing the right thing, that I'm following the right path. I do it all the time. So when I was waiting to hear back from this grant, I prayed something that felt really silly and juvenile. I asked God to give me that money if I should be doing what I'm doing. See, I have another job, a job I like, but I don't love. But a job that has more security and staying power. And if I worked there more, creative encounter would not exist by my hand. And the thought of that makes me recoil. I need creative encountering as much or more than it needs me. It's the thing that's given more color to my life, more power to my voice, more depth and intentionality to my actions. And I have asked for and received a number of signs. Signs where I felt affirmed that I am doing God's work. Words from the mouth of prophets. Love in ways I've never known. Happiness that fulfills me. Collaboration on creative works that speaks to me, inspires me, and so many others. But this one, this sign I asked for, was specific. I was trying to bargain with God. I was trying to force the hand of the one who knows what I need better than I ever could. See, all the other prayers were open-ended prayers. Lord, open my eyes so that I may see what I should be doing. But this prayer stemmed from fear, not faith. So, when I got my answer, no money for me, I felt betrayed and wrecked. But later that evening, when I was studying this text again, something new in 2 Corinthians struck me. It was the part about God not giving us riches and prosperity as a way of affirming that we are doing his will. That actually we get a cross and we get to bear that cross. And bearing that cross is part of the journey towards redemption. I learned a new bit of theology in regards to pain as I prepared for this sermon. Theodicy. It's hard to define because essentially it's an attempt to answer a question. A question of the existence of a sovereign God congruent with the existence of evil, pain, and suffering. It takes on this idea that a sovereign God, a God who reigns supreme over us, would allow such horrible things in our lives if he truly loves us. But I can't wrap my head or my heart around a supreme warrior God who lords over us. That doesn't fit with the picture of God as love that we see throughout Scripture. If God doesn't reign over us, then he's just with us. God's with us in our pain and our weeping. He's with us in our weaknesses. God's with us in our fear and our lust and our indecision and doubt and injustices. And God feels it all with us. She holds us in the parts of our journey that are ugly and loves us when we don't get it right, when we need her to lift us and love us, when we need God. We need God. Here's something I don't like to admit. I need help with creative encountering. I can't do it all by myself. My creativity, my work, my ideas alone aren't enough. I need help raising my child. My patience, my playfulness, my love aren't enough on their own. I need help with grief. My tears, my heart, my self-sufficiency alone are not enough. I need family. I need friends. I need a lover. I need you. I need God. I have a hard time telling anyone that I need them, and it's not unusual. I'm not special. We're conditioned by our society to believe that we need to do it all ourselves. Our self-worth comes from autonomy. Western culture tells us we are to be individualists, but that doesn't leave much room for compassion and vulnerability. We can enter into authenticity through the doorway of vulnerability. Vulnerability leaves less room for judgment. And defining other people by their thorns is an exhausting way to live. It doesn't allow for our own spirits to be free. It means moving in perpetual assessment of others' shortcomings instead of holding ourselves accountable for our own stuff. This is codependency. It's unhealthy, it's dysfunctional, and it's destructive. A few Sundays ago at our One Body service, we talked about what ways God shines a light through each of us. I wrote of the light in me being in my ability to love others. Isn't that pretty? I want to add something to that. I shine God's light in my ability to show my weaknesses. I allow God in when I make room for strength that is of God. I'm here to tell you that this sermon was only written by allowing myself to be a vessel. Because when I tried to write it from a point of my own intellect, it was flat, one-dimensional, and dull. But when I admitted my thorns, when I owned my weaknesses and ineptness, I made room for God to speak through me. I made room for God's great grace. Koinonia, where do you need God's great grace today?
The end.